All right, welcome back to Bigfoot's Wilderness. Let me start by saying that this encounter story is slightly different in that I've actually had a version of this encounter story sitting in my inbox for over 2 years, back when I was Blue Ridge Bigfoot. And me being me, I had some questions, so I replied back but never got a return message. Well, recently I've received almost the same encounter story once again, slightly different in respect to location, and again, me being me, with lots of questions, I responded, and again, haven't received a reply back. So, what the heck? I'm going to read this encounter story, and I certainly hope you enjoy it. This, of course, is, I'm going to assume, it's been passed down by third party. So let's go ahead and jump into it. Many falls ago, so many that I can't even remember the year, my brother shot a huge Alaskan brown bear. It was immensely blocky, heavy, and muscular. We had tracked it on and off for several days and had come across an interesting area near a creek littered with strawberry bushes, and it looked like the scene of an epic battle. There wasn't much in the way of tracks, as there were quite a few rocky areas, but it looked like two bulldozers had gone at each other. Saplings were snapped like soda straws. Bushes had been ripped up out of the ground, and bits of fur were scattered here and there. My brother presumed that this particular bear had laid down the law about territory ownership to a competing bear. We were hot on his trail when I noticed something curious. It was a tree branch, maybe 4.5 to 5 feet long, and I'd say a good 5 to 6 inches in diameter, and tapered slightly. It obviously had been torn off a nearby tree. I looked at it twice as we moved around and through the area, because the larger end had blood and fur on it. I just assumed at the time one of the bears had slammed into it while fighting. The next day, when we caught up with the brown bear, he was bedded down in a deep thicket. We circled around and got into position at the edge of a small clearing, just as the old bear came out. He seemed to move slowly, almost stiff-like, up the mountain. My brother got him with 2 shots with his .416. Nothing dramatic. So we both got to work skinning, and that's when we were surprised at the condition of this old bear. He was really beat up, and clearly one sorely battered bear that had some very unusual wounds from its fight. Once we rolled him over, there were big areas on his chest and stomach where the fur had been pulled out in clumps, as well as claw marks. I thought it looked like something had jumped on its back and had its arms around him, holding him while it was biting him. At first, we kind of joked and thought maybe cougar, but that would have to be one hell of a beast like no one's ever seen. But the marks were wrong. A cat wouldn't pull fur out, and it can't clench its paws into a fist. The claw marks seemed wide and more shallow. They were spread wide apart between what could only be fingers. If you hold down your hand and spread out your fingers, they spread pretty far apart. Big brown bears, such as mine, have claws up to 4, 4.5, 5 inches. But there are only 4 on the front paw. The 5th is a dew claw further up its wrist. There were 5 of these, one in an opposable thumb position. What was just as weird was when the huge hide was off up to its neck, there were several large bite marks on the bear's neck and shoulders. The curious thing is they were not as deep as you would expect from a competing bear, and teeth marks were more rounded or molar-like and in a horseshoe-shaped pattern. A bear's bite is much longer and narrower. The long and short of it was that one of the guides gave the following account of what probably had happened. The massive bear had come up the creek into the wind and probably surprised a female Bigfoot in his berry patch and attacked. However, there just happens to be a big male Bigfoot that jumped him from cover where he had been feeding. The guides have said that the big male Bigfoot are easily 9 feet tall and 750 to 800 pounds. They're immensely strong, obviously. Anyway, the fight was on, horrific but brief. The female did not join in but fled with her youngster. As soon as the female was safely out of danger, the male broke off and followed. Everything forensically indicates that the big male Bigfoot had inflicted some pretty severe bites to the bear, but the massively strong old bear had gotten him off his back. The bear, they say, had inflicted a severe bite to probably the big male's thigh and probably several nasty off-balance paw swats. If the bear's feet had been under him to provide power and leverage, the male Bigfoot would have been crushed. The local guides say such encounters are rare, but do happen when they surprise each other. True? Who knows? But my brother and I have hunted all over the world, him more than I, and we've taken several other bears. He's skinned hundreds of animals and said those wound marks sure did not look like anything that came from another bear. Another strange and weird thing was that the bear really stunk, especially on his back. Now, a bear in the wild, in damp, soggy, and muddy conditions, isn't going to smell very good, of course. But having carried quite a few bears out, I can best describe them as musty old rugs that have been laying around on a damp basement for quite a spell. I agreed, but said this was different. The bear's back smelled foul, like whatever was clinging on back there smelled so bad that it's possible he urinated on the bear while fighting. We likened the odor to urine, feces, and rotted meat all mixed together. Anyway, that's the story. My brother and I, we begged the guides about tracking the Bigfoot family, but they simply said there wasn't enough money in the world to get them to do something as foolish as track a mad, wounded, protective Bigfoot. Besides, they said, late in the fall, they always went back towards the coast to several super nasty, what they called hellhole little canyons, where they thought they might have natural hot springs and possibly winter there. An interesting footnote. Some outfitters told my big brother that the season for salmon fishing was about over, and one guide rode his older Kawasaki snowmobile back to the area to bring out some gear he'd left. Apparently, he parked the snowmobile on the ridge above the infamous fight scene, not thinking anything really. He decided to go down to the little river and see about catching a few salmon. There was not much snow on the ridge, mostly ice. But further below, he snowshoed down about a half mile and fished for about an hour. He caught 4 salmon and climbed back out to discover his snow machine was gone. It had been picked up and shoved down the other side of the ridge, and it weighed almost 500 pounds. Fortunately for him, as he was 20 miles back in, it hung up on a bush only about 30 feet down the ridgeside. After some struggle, fueled by a great desire to get the hell out of there, he got it back on its track, got it started, and got the hell out of there with only a smashed windshield and cracked hood. I think that's a subtle way of saying, get the hell away from us and leave us alone.